Today we will be discussing about processing of library material, classification and cataloging. The technical processing section in every library plays a key role to carry out functions of any library. The journey of every document in the library to reach its readers starts from acquisition section, but it is the technical section that, after the documents have been acquired, prepares these for use by the users. It therefore acts as a bridge between the acquisition of documents to the circulation of documents. This section attends to all the technical activities by the professional technical staff for the library. The activities done here are chiefly classification of documents, cataloging of documents, then physical processing of documents, shelving the documents, and filing of library materials. The objectives of this particular lesson that we are going to discuss are, firstly, explain the need for technical processing of a library material. Secondly, identify the steps in technical processing. For example, the steps are classification, cataloging, physical processing, shelving, and filing of library material. Thirdly, state the purpose of library classification. Besides this, we will try to list the various schemes of library classification that are available in present libraries for organizing the library collection. We'll also explain to you the use of cataloging of library material. Then learners will also describe what a library catalog and cataloging is all about. We will also explain to you what a dictionary catalog is and what a classified catalog is. And besides this, we will also list some of the popular cataloging codes. Let's now take a look at what the technical processing section of a library does. The technical processing section plays a key role in carrying out the functions of any library. As we have already said, the journey of every document in the library to reach its readers starts from the acquisition section. So, it is the technical section that acquires the documents and prepares these for use by the users. So, therefore, it acts as a bridge between the acquisition of documents and their circulation. This section attends to all technical activities by the professional technical staff of the library. The activities carried out by technical section are the next aspect that has to be taken into consideration. So, learners, the activities which are carried out by technical processing section are, firstly, classification, secondly, cataloging, thirdly, physical processing of documents, fourthly, shelving, and lastly, filing of library material. In this particular lesson, we will chiefly discuss what classification is all about and what cataloging is all about. Let's now take a look at what is the need for technical processing of documents. As you are all aware, tremendous growth of information resulting from production of a wide variety of library material has necessitated that we categorize the documents. So, there is necessity of categorization of the universe of knowledge. Then, arranging of information has to be carried out in such a way that subject specialization is maintained. In addition to this, systematic arrangement of documents to facilitate easy storage and retrieval. So, it's here that cataloging comes to our help. And besides this, satisfaction of users' needs, because users who come to the library are to be satisfied, because whatever material they require, that has to be provided. Let's now see what are the basic steps in technical processing. As we have already said, first step is classification, second step is cataloging, thirdly, preparation of shelf list, and fourthly, labeling the documents. In this particular lesson, we are going to discuss chiefly what classification is all about, what cataloging is all about, and how to prepare a shelf list. Let's now start with what classification is all about. Library classification has been defined by several experts in various ways. So one of the very important definition of library classification is grouping of documents having the same or similar subject content. Library classification is also a system of arrangement adopted by libraries to enable users to find their material quickly and easily. All the books in the library, irrespective of their size, no matter when written, are naturally grouped together when they belong to the same subject. Therefore, library classification by subject is essential for all library material. Let's now see what is the purpose of library classification. The various purposes of library classification are to arrange library material in a manner which is most helpful to the user, and not only the user as well as the library staff. In addition to that, library classification replaces the material in their proper place on the shelves after use by the users, because once the books have been returned after use by the users, these has to be placed on their proper place. So library classification helps in that activity. Then besides this, library classification facilitates removal of unwanted material from the shelves, because whichever material is not much used or not at all used can be removed from the library shelves. Besides this, it ensures that there is a scope to place newly acquired material on the shelves in their proper place, because whatever the material comes every year, that has to be put in a proper place. So library classification helps in that. And then library classification helps to the materials on the shelves as indicated, shown by the library catalog. And lastly, it provides every document an individual class number so that it has an individual number. In fact, a classification number is a kind of a surrogate which is provided to every document. Now, in connection with library classification learners, let's now know what notation is all about. Notation is defined as a system of numbers which is used to represent the classes, that is, the subjects in a library classification scheme. It is essential in every scheme of classification as it serves as a symbol in place of a term. As notation makes up the class number, it can be described as the standard abbreviation of the classification scheme. The system of providing notation is referred to as notational system. The notational system consists of Arabic numerals, Roman letters, which could be both small and cap, punctuation marks, mathematical symbols. In fact, different schemes of classification use different kinds of notation. As we will be talking to you in the further slides, you will see that some classification schemes have only numerals, but otherwise some may have the alphabets also. Now learners, let's take a look at what the qualities of good notation are. A good notation should have some qualities which include, firstly, simplicity, secondly, brevity, and thirdly, pronounceability. Why simplicity? Because if it is simple, it will be very easy for anyone to read and follow, write and remember. Secondly, brevity. If it is brief, it will be easy to remember by the users. And if you can easily pronounce it, then again, it will be very, very user friendly. So these three qualities are really essential in any good notation. Let's take a look at one example. In the subject of education, the notation in the Dewey Decimal Classification is 370 or 370. And then notation in the colon classification will be T. Then in chemistry, notation in Dewey Decimal Classification is 540. Notation in colon classification is E. In the subject of library science, in Dewey Decimal Classification, notation is 020, and in CC it is 2. And lastly, in the subject of history, notation in DDC is 900, whereas notation in CC is V. So you have seen that how easy it is to write notation in any classification scheme. Let us now take a look at what the call number is all about, because in the connection with library classification, we have to call the books, and a call number is provided on all the books. The purpose of the call number is to provide the address for an item in the library. The address in this case is where the staff will be sure to shelf the particular item and where the user can look for the item. This address also allows the user to browse the collection to find out the available item on any given topic. The idea of creating this address or call number for each item in the library is that each item can have only one address. Let's see how a call number is constructed. A call number has several components. Firstly, the class number, that is the classification number, which indicates the subject of the document. Secondly, the book number. The book has been published in a particular year or by a particular author. So, books on the same subject will have different book numbers. Then there is the collection number. Depends on the kind of collection. It is a reference collection, or it is fiction, or it is a subject collection. And lastly, copy number. That means there may be 10 copies of a particular book in the library. So each book has to have its individual call number. So copy number will differentiate one particular copy of the book from the other. Let's take a look at an example according to Dewey Decimal Classification. A book entitled Principles of Physics by the author P.V. Naik will have the following call number according to Dewey Decimal Classification. It will be D530NAI. Here D stands for collection number for main collection for users of the library, that can be books that can be lent to the users. Then 530 is class number for the subject physics. And lastly, NAI, that is book number from the first three letters of the author's surname, Naik. So NAI. In many cases, the book number could also be according to the year of publication. Now, let's take a look at an example according to the colon classification. A book entitled Elementary Education by M.K. Sengupta, published in the year 1972, will have the following call number according to colon classification. It will be T15N72TD. Here, T15 is class number for elementary education. N72 is book number according to year of publication, that is 1972. And TD, this is collection number indicating that the book belongs to education department. Now, this is as per a table given in the colon classification scheme schedules. Let's now learn about some of the schemes of library classification. In fact, there are several library classification schemes which are used worldwide, but most popular amongst them are the BLIS bibliographic classification given by a very famous person called BLIS. Then there is the colon classification. This is given by Dr. S. R. Ranganathan. This is the most popular scheme in India. And then Dewey Decimal Classification. Originator for this was Melville Dewey. In fact, this was the first popular classification scheme that came into being in libraries. Then there is the Library of Congress classification, and based on the Dewey Decimal Classification, there is the Universal Decimal Classification. So although there are many, many more classification schemes, but we are only talking about a few of them. Now let's take a look at the features of the Dewey Decimal Classification scheme. as I have already said earlier, Dewey Decimal Classification's originator was Melville Dewey, and it has several important features which make this classification the most popular worldwide, and especially in India, in many of the college and school and the public libraries, DDC is being used. Now, let's see, take a look at its features. There is use of pure Arabic numbers in notation. Then there is use of decimal to specify subject terms that is specified and specific. Then the scheme is compact and available in 4 volumes. This I am talking or referring to the latest edition of Dewey Decimal Classification. Earlier editions had even 1 volume or 2 volumes or 3 volumes. The latest one is having 4 volumes. Then there is availability of mnemonic device that facilitates easy recall of classification number. Now, mnemonic device is a device which facilitates the use of repetitive numbers in similar cases. Then the DDC also employs 3 minimum digits to the left of the decimal, and there is availability of relative index for the diverse material in the schedules. Let's take a look at now the main classes of Dewey Decimal Classification. Because the DDC is a very simple scheme of classification, it has basically 10 main classes. These are 000 generalities, 100 philosophy and psychology, 200 religion, 300 social sciences, 400 language, 500 natural science and mathematics, 600 technology, that is applied sciences, 700 the arts, 800 literature and rhetorics, and 900 that is geography and history. Now, learners, let's now know about the Kolon classification scheme. In fact, this is the most popular scheme in our country because the originator, Dr. S. Ranganathan, was from our own country. So, Kolon classification scheme for the first time was designed in 1933 by Dr. S. Ranganathan. Kolon classification is an analytico-synthetic scheme. The schedules of CC consist of certain standard unit schedules. By combining the numbers in different unit schedules, class number can be constructed for any subject. That is why it is called analytico-synthetic scheme. The universe of knowledge here is divided on the basis of subjects which are known as main classes. The first edition of the scheme was brought out in 1933, as already mentioned, and the 7th edition is the latest edition. But the 7th edition is not much in use. So, it is the 6th revised edition that is widely used. For this reason, we will discuss here about the 6th edition of Kolon classification, which was first published in 1960 and revised in 1963. Dear learners, we have already seen what library classification is all about. Let's now know about what library catalogs and library cataloging is all about. Why we need the library catalogs? The reason is that once the books have been acquired and classified by the library, these need to be accessed by the users. So, for that, we need to provide several access points, and library catalogs enable us to provide several access points to the documents to be accessed by the library. So, for this, library catalogs are required. Now, let's define a library catalog. A library catalog can be defined as a list of books, maps, stamps, sound recordings, or any other reading material that can constitute part of a library collection. Its main purpose is to record, describe, and index the holdings of any library collection. The library catalog, therefore, is a tool that will list out and describe, according to a consistent plan, the print and non-print resources available in the library. Besides this, it provides, gives directions to the users to similar materials, because whatever documents are on a same subject, the catalog will lead the users to that particular place on the shelf. Then we can record the collection of the library. Besides this, it indicates the location of the resources, because when we take a look at the library catalog, it will tell us which document can be found at which classification or class number. Then lastly, it assists users in obtaining the skills of information retrieval. There are several uses of library cataloging, because the library catalog enables users to retrieve information efficiently. It increases understanding by students and staff of information retrieval systems, plan, order, and check resources efficiently, and develop information retrieval skills. Let's take a look at now the process of cataloging. The cataloging has several steps. Basically, in the process of cataloging, we take a look at some of the cataloging codes which tell us how to prepare the catalog cards. In fact, in the modern times, all this has been replaced by the computers. So anyway, the process of cataloging remains the same, whether manual or by automation. Firstly, preparation of the main entry. Secondly, preparation of added entries. Thirdly, assignment of subject headings. Fourthly, preparation of reference entries, if any. Then writing of the tracings on the main entry. And then it leads to preparing the shelf list card. Checking of the catalog cards by the senior personnel is then carried out before it can actually be released for use by the users. Then alphabetization of cataloging cards is also carried out. And the last step here in the process of cataloging is filing of catalog cards. Now, in this connection, we'll mention the very fact that process of preparing a shelf list and a library catalog is almost the same. The only difference is that catalog is for use by the general public, but on the other hand, the shelf list is for use by only the library staff members. Dear learners, let's now take a look at the OPACs. OPAC is an acronym for Online Public Access Catalog. Because we are presently computerizing our catalogs and carrying out the cataloging process as part of the library automation projects, we require the OPACs in our libraries. So, what exactly is an OPAC? OPAC is an online database of material held by a library or a group of libraries. OPAC contains all the bibliographic information of a library and is, in other words, a gateway to a library's collection. OPAC is not only used on a standalone computer, but can also be put on the intranet or internet. This makes it possible for a library to extend its services not only to its users, but also to the other interested persons of the locality, region, nation, or the entire world. Now, for example, we can have access to the OPAC of any library which has completely computerized and puts its OPAC on internet, sitting at our own laptop or desktop. OPAC, or computerized catalog, is very dynamic in the sense that it is highly flexible, easy and economical to maintain, and capable of meeting almost every possible approach of the users. The searching capability is also very fast and accurate. And besides this, it is very user-friendly also. There is no scope for error also, because earlier when the catalog cards were prepared manually, a lot of errors would occur and a lot of paperwork would be required. All that is now not required at all. Let's now take a look at what web OPACs are all about. The web OPACs are the OPAC which is on the web. Web OPAC is an OPAC which is provided on the web, and with the help of internet, a user can have access to the library material or its details from anywhere or anytime access. Whereas OPAC can facilitate the user's access to material while in the particular library, Web OPAC has the advantage of being available worldwide and is accessible anytime. The status of a book may be known as the book is issued or on a shelf, lost or transferred, etc. Here, an interface exists to provide access to the system in a manner that is complete, efficient, and acceptable to the users. So, as Web OPAC is accessible through internet, it is possible to search it independently for any user from anywhere by author, keyword, title, or year of the publication. Then complete bibliographic information is also made available in the Web OPAC. The library catalogs can be dictionary catalogs or classified catalogs. So dictionary catalog is one where everything is in a one alphabetical sequence. The classified catalog is basically a classified list which has two parts, a classified part and the alphabetical part. Dear learners, let's see what we have learned in this particular lesson. We have discussed that technical processing work consists of classification and cataloging of documents. Classification provides a system for organizing of knowledge. We have seen that notation is a system of symbols used to represent the classes in a classification scheme. Preparation of the cataloging work includes preparation of main entry and added entries for the documents, assigning subject headings, and preparing of shelf list. Due to developments in IT, from the traditional card catalog, users have facility of locating documents via the OPAC and internet. This facility has enabled us to have any time and anywhere access of material from the libraries. Two most popular inner forms of catalog are dictionary catalog and the classified catalog. So, learners, we have seen what classification and cataloging is all about. And we come to the end of this lesson. Thank you, learners.